Bueno, me da mucho gusto presentar al doctor Gabriel del Río. Él es investigador titular del Instituto de Fisiología Celular y tiene una trayectoria pues, muy distinguida desde que empezó en el Instituto Tecnológico de Sonora como ingeniero bioquímico. Se formó, ya tuvo su doctorado en el Instituto de Biotecnología de nuestra Universidad de Cuernavaca y ha hecho una serie de postdoctorados en el Burnham Institute de San Diego, California, en el Bob Institute de Novato, California, en la Universidad Humboldt en Berlín él es alguien que se ha dedicado utilizando como herramienta fármacos para ver atender problemas de salud y también el performance. Platicaba yo con él hace un momento, ¿cuál es el performance? Bueno, en ustedes el performance es lograr el doctorado, el ser investigadores muy. I was planning to say this in English, now that I see you. I was talking about Dr. Gabriel del Río and his trajectory. His PhD here in Mexico and several PhDs in the United States and the use of pharmaceuticals, both to deal with health problems and the performance. Performance that we can measure here in the students, the academic performance, and their future performance as researchers who have here with Dr. Constance Jeffrey a very good example of great performance. Besides learning our enlightened proteins, they have a good example of what is important as performance in a scientist. But in real life, he's very interested in the study of structure function of proteins. And for those like me, who are still young, but not as young as some of you, the study of the knowledge of structure performance was a distant goal, but now with all the technological advances, and especially the bioinformatic advances that allow to make sense of this big data that has been produced. Something that was a dream becomes a reality. That's why in the United States, and in other countries like Mexico, we believe, and I think Dr. I imagine that Dr. Jeffrey believes in the dreamers, isn't it? The dreamers are the ones who make the dreams become real. So, Dr. Gabriel del Río will present the lecture, Is Moonlighting Required at Metabolic Crossroads for Cell Survival?
Okay. Well, thank you all for being here. Thank you, Antonio, for your kind presentation, and Alicia for the invitation as well, and Constance for being here, and all of you as well. I hope I will show you and convince you of the meaning of that question and the relevance of finding out the answer to it. If you are not familiar with moonlighting proteins, perhaps if you like movies, you became aware of the term moonlight, because precisely this year the best movie was awarded to Moonlight. So that's a premonition that this year is the year for moonlighting proteins. Hopefully not in that fashion, like in what happened in the Oscars awards, but let's hope that this will be better than that. The year of moonlighting proteins. So in my talk I will explain some of the aspects of moonlighting proteins that Constance defined some almost 20 years ago already now, 18, that to me are quite interesting, and the presence of this type of proteins is pushing back some ideas that we have in biology to rethink about what we thought we knew. And one of them is this aspect, that moonlighting is a special case of multifunctionality in proteins. As you know, or probably don't, depending on what knowledge you have of the history of molecular biology, at the beginning, proteins were thought to be designed by nature to have one single function, one single molecular activity. But that changed when we learned that many proteins have more than one activity. And moonlighting is one special case of that. There are two, let's say, cases for multifunctionality in proteins. The first one to be recognized is the one that is on top here. These are gene fusions, where you have proteins that are the result of fusing two independent domains, and that polypeptide works with multiple functions, if each domain having a different function. In eukaryotes, about 80% of proteins have these fusions of domains. In prokaryotes, the proportion is lesser than that, it's about 60%. But we don't know how many of those proteins that are one single domain proteins will have more than one activity. So the expectancy is that probably all proteins will be multifunctional. But that's just a brief summary of the history of the multifunctionality of proteins. But one interesting question is, in nature, what we have learned by the fusion of domains in proteins is that only very few fusions exist among all possible fusions. Less than 0.5% of all possible fusions are the ones that we observe in nature. Why is that restriction? And the same question applies for moonlighting proteins. What type of functions are capable of being fused in a single domain? So perhaps answering that question will reveal the reason why in nature only certain fusions are observed. But that is a question that awaits for an answer in this field. And the relevance of that, as Antonio Velázquez was pointing out before, my interest is in development of drugs that will work for treating diseases or improving performance. The only way that I can do this is if I understand how molecular mechanisms in cells work. If I assume that cells use proteins to do one single thing, and in reality proteins are doing multiple things, then I will fail every single time that I design a drug. That is the reason why it's important to understand the structure-function relationship in proteins for designing drugs. The other aspect that is important about the concept of moonlighting proteins is that when it was presented, the concept represented a paradox for the current state of mind in the understanding of the structure function of proteins. And the paradox is explained in this slide. Basically, in the late 90s, protein engineering and phylogenies were pretty much beginning to do things. So they were capable of mutating one single residue at a time in a protein, or two or three, and phylogenies were available for very few sequences in comparison with today's availability of sequences. And based on that limited number of information we have, which is phylogenetic and mutagenesis experiment in the late 90s, the idea we had about the tolerance of proteins to mutation was that these proteins were very intolerant to mutations. Every single mutation reported in the literature will affect negatively the activity of a protein. And that experience in mutagenesis was supported by the few sequences available on protein sequences. That was, most sequences were similar to each other, so that suggested that evolution maintained the same sequence with the purpose of not affecting the function of the protein. So how come then was possible that having a protein with a function at the beginning, you can evolve another function in that same protein without losing the first function if that protein couldn't tolerate much mutations? Okay, so that was a paradox that was presented when the moonlighting concept was presented. But nowadays, thanks to the development of high-throughput DNA sequencing and robotics in biology and biochemistry, we now know that proteins are highly tolerant to mutations. And this discrepancy now explains or solves the paradox. The proteins are actually highly tolerant to mutations. And so phylogenies not anymore dictate or explain the mutability of proteins. So the third aspect, which is the one that I will talk to you about, is can moonlighting proteins be predicted computationally? And the reason for this question is because if we can model what moonlighting proteins are, then that gives us an idea, an intuitive idea of how these proteins emerge in nature and what could be the purpose of these proteins. And there are some software that has been developed in the literature for predicting moonlighting proteins, and most of these softwares are based on sequence comparison. And the problem with those approaches is that, and it has been pointed out by different authors, is that, this is what I explained in this slide. Let's assume that the space in which protein sequence and protein function falls looks like what I'm presenting here in this option A. So every single symbol that you see here represents a protein. Okay? Proteins that are very similar to each other are represented with the same color. And proteins with different symbols represent different functions. Okay? So if the protein sequence and protein function space look like this, for any computational approach based on sequence comparison, it will be very easy to identify proteins with different functions, because any distance between this set of proteins is smaller than any distance between this member and any other member of this set. So the distance or the divergence among these sequences that belongs to different groups of functions is much bigger than the divergence between members of proteins that have exactly the same function. So if the space of the protein sequence and protein function will be like this, then sequence comparisons will solve this problem. Unfortunately, we know, I'm not presenting this data, it's just a summary, we know that the sequence and protein function space look like this. There are many cases in which members or proteins that have different functions are much more similar to proteins that have a different function than other sequences that have exactly the same function of the protein of reference. For example, this protein is much more similar to this protein that has a different function than to this other protein that has the same function than this one. So, in this week, for example, one student in the institute presented a seminar where alcohol dehydrogenases were analyzed, and many proteins that were thought that were alcohol dehydrogenases, when they were characterized, happened to be not to be alcohol dehydrogenases, because by sequence comparison they look like alcohol dehydrogenases. So the sequences, protein sequence space, protein function space look like this. So using sequence comparison will not solve or will not define these boundaries for identifying or relating the protein sequence with the protein function. Instead of that, what we can use are algorithms derived from machine learning approaches. And those are pretty good in identifying boundaries in these kind of situations. We have done that, and we have the state of the art in identifying protein structures. But the point is that for those cases to work, you need to have many examples. And unfortunately, there aren't that many number of examples to train machine learning algorithms. For some few proteins for which the function is well characterized, you can do that, but there aren't that many number of examples. Now, if you add to this situation, or to this situation, the concept of moonlighting, then this cannot be any more solved. Okay? So by simply using sequence comparison, you can't solve this problem. It could be solved only if you use machine learning, but machine learning requires many examples, and Constance Jeffrey has done an excellent job for the community, giving access to all the known characterized moonlighting proteins, and there are so far 217 moonlighting proteins so far. So those are very few examples. You can't use protein sequence and machine learning to distinguish those from the rest. So the problem then cannot be solved from that perspective. How can this problem be solved? How can you predict moonlighting proteins from using computers? That means creating an intuitive model to help us understand how these proteins work, this development in nature. And this idea was proposed around 2004, the concept in just in time. So in metabolism, it was proposed theoretically that cells will not waste the expression of proteins unless they are necessary. Let's say, for example, if I need to expend 10 ATP molecules to synthesize a protein, and the production of that protein will generate only one ATP for the cell, that is an expenditure that cells in some situations will not do. Okay, because it's too expensive. It will end up with a negative production of ATP, and that will kill the cell eventually. So the just-in-time concept offers an alternative. It says that cells will only produce proteins when they are required and just in the time when they are needed. And in E. coli, Uri alone pretty much observed that. What he did is he created a series of strains, and in this case I'm showing you only for the arginine pathway. What he did is he created fusions of proteins that produce light or fluorescence that were induced by a promoter of the gene that was part of the arginine biosynthesis pathway. In this, and what you see here is in blue is when the protein was not produced, when it's red is when the protein was produced by the cell. So in this media there was no arginine, so the cell had to produce arginine. And what he observed is that depending on the position of the gene in the pathway, the time at which the gene was produced or the protein was produced. What you see here is the first one to be produced was this enzyme, the regulator of the arginine, and then the next one was the urge A, and then B, and so on and so forth. So this experiment proved that the concept of just-in-time, that cells will not waste energy simply producing proteins at any time, was correct in the case of metabolism. But this was a prokaryote, and other groups start working on eukaryotes, and the latest advances on that was published in 2014, so 10 years after was this, where Eda Klip modeled, using experimental data, the diauxid shift in Saccharomyces cerevisiae. The diauxid shift in Saccharomyces cerevisiae is the transition of metabolism going from an aerobic glycolysis, the consumption of glucose in the presence of oxygen, to an aerobic use of ethanol to produce ATP. This is a condition when cells are running out of glucose and they need to keep using and producing energy. So the cell is put in a situation where it has to optimize its resources, in this case the production of proteins. And what Eda showed, I won't go into the details, is that the just-in-time concept also applies to this situation. The problem with these models is that she recognized, and many other authors have recognized, that the solution of this problem is computationally demanding, too demanding. So they were able to model, for example, assuming reducing the number of genes to only four or six reactions to model the whole situation. Because if they include too many steps, the computation will be too demanding. So this background will give us an idea when moonlighting proteins are required. If you happen to be in a situation where you need to be efficient in the production of a protein, then this is the condition where moonlighting could be important, because moonlight is a way of having multiple functions in the smallest size of a polypeptide. Now, since computationally this still cannot be solved, an alternative is our hypothesis. It's not addressing when, but where. And this is the title of the presentation. Basically, the hypothesis is that the moonlighting activity is required at metabolic crossroads for cell survival. Okay, what do I mean by crossroads, metabolic crossroads? Well, proteins, as well as metabolism, don't live in isolation in the cell. Metabolism is a process that it's constantly in interaction with other processes in the cell. And the proteins that participate in metabolism also participate in other processes in the cell, which is pretty much the definition of a multifunctional role for proteins. And if that protein happens to have a single domain, then that is a moon-like protein. So what we propose then is that given a genome and assuming that there is transcription and translation of the proteins in this genome, there will be some proteins that will participate in metabolism, and some of these proteins will also be part of the cytoskeleton or cell signaling pathways in the cell. And the point is, which one of these proteins that are part of this other cellular process became important for cell survival? This will be the condition where just-in-time concept applies. But as I said, we cannot model the time here, so we will assume this as a static model. And to address this problem, we had to deal with two important aspects. The first one is we have no idea what defines the criticality or the indispensability of a gene or a protein in a cellular context. The other one is that we do not know either the complete metabolic network, which is something that to me now it's surprising to see that many students, when they are presented to the classes in metabolism, they think after being exposed to the knowledge that has been accumulated that now we know all the metabolic network for any given organism, and that is not the case. Not even for E. coli, which is the best characterized organism, or yeast, or humans, we have no idea what's the real metabolic structure for any organism. So if we want to predict moon-like proteins based on this hypothesis, and we have no idea what the structure of this metabolic network is, how can we predict that? No? To address that uncertainty, what we did is we developed this model, this method. We created multiple models of metabolism and multiple ways to predict what is important for a protein in this network for the cell survival. In this case, anything that is important for metabolism, for primary metabolism, should be relevant for cell survival. So if you knock out a protein that is important for primary metabolism, the cell will not survive. Okay? And making these combinations, in this case we created 80 different models of metabolic networks. I won't go into the details, but if you're interested I can explain you this later. And 16 different ways of estimating from this network what is important for the function of these metabolic networks. And after this, we performed a statistical analysis and came out with the concept of rich on essential metabolic genes networks. So whatever I got from this procedure is a network that will be enriched by genes that are easily predicted as critical. Okay? And those that are easily predicted as critical should be matching those that are known to be indispensable for cell growth. Okay. When we apply this to yeast, before I explain the results, I will just give you a brief summary of the statistical way in which we identify the best network and centrality, which is summarizing in this side of the image. So if you want to evaluate any prediction, whatever prediction you have, even the ones that politicians or people following sports are doing, you need to evaluate two statistical parameters, no matter whatever prediction is, including moonlighting proteins. These are sensitivity and specificity. Sensibility, what it means is from the predictions you made, how many of those predictions are correct. That is sensibility. Specificity is those that you said that are not important in this case, to be critical genes for cell survival, how many of those are truly not critical for cell survival? So the correct evaluation of a predictor is not only how many true predictions you make, but also how many of the ones that you said that are not part of the group that you want to predict are really not part of that group. Okay? So, using these two criteria, you can create what is called the receiver operator curve, or ROC curve, which is presented here. Basically, any prediction will have some sort of this behavior. Okay? To explain you briefly, if I have an absurd predictor that says, if I have a specificity of 100, and I say, from all these genes that I have in this genome, none of them is critical, then the specificity that I get is 100%. Okay? But the sensibility, that is how many critical genes that are known to be critical I will be predicting correctly, will be zero. So my point in this curve will be here. But I can have another absurd predictor, which could be here, that will say, from all these genes that I have in the genome, all of them are critical for survival. In that case, my sensibility will be 100%, but my specificity will be zero, because all the ones that are not critical, I won't be able to predict. Okay, but all the other predictors, the ones that are not absurd, like these ones, will fall in this trend that I'm showing you here. This trend will create an area under this trend that is what we call the area under the curve, the ROC curve. Okay, and the closer to one is this curve, the better the prediction is. Okay. So, when I apply this method that I described to you here to these 18 metabolic networks from yeast and 16 different closeness centrality, what we learned is that our efficiency of prediction was in this range. But for 18 times 16 is about 144 different combinations. And or more. The number of networks that will be above the random prediction, which is 0.5, is below what you will expect by chance. That means that using a single centrality, we couldn't predict any real essential gene. Then we start, and this was important because at that time many groups were predicting essential groups, essential genes based on centralities, but they never did this type of statistical analysis. So this was useful to correct this other type of predictions. So you cannot predict the essentiality or the criticality of a gene using a single centrality based on the metabolic networks that were published back in those days. So combining centralities gave us a performance, the level of prediction that was above the randomness, and the best network among these ones was able to predict 81 out of the 131 known indispensable genes in metabolism for cell survival. The best network was the one obtained from Keck. This is a Japanese public database of metabolism. And also another one published by the group of Palsum. Any one of these two, using the combination of the inverse of a centrality that is called clustering coefficient and closeness, will render the best prediction. What is the meaning of this? What it means is that genes that are indispensable for metabolism in Saccharomyces cerevisiae happens to be either at the beginning of a pathway or to be central to the overall metabolism. Okay? The fact that we learn that dose that happens to be at the beginning of a pathway is consistent with the just-in-time idea that I mentioned to you before. Because those are the first ones to be synthesized. Without that one, you can't produce the rest of the metabolites. That's why they become critical, or more important than the other ones. So this we published back in 2009, and since then we realized that even though that we succeed in predicting these 62% of known indispensable genes for yeast survival, we weren't able to predict much. Okay, it's only 62%. And in this report, we argue that the problem we have is because the completeness of the metabolic network was too short, and we needed to have more data to complete the network. In an attempt to solve this problem, to make more complete the network, the metabolic network in yeast, a student in my group was motivated in using other type of interactions reported for proteins in yeast. And at that time, there were these seven different databases, public databases, that reported different type of interactions between proteins in yeast. GI means genetic interactions, PPI means protein-protein interactions, HT means high throughput protein-protein interactions, LCC means literature curated correlations, and MC means manually curated. Okay? So using these seven different networks, we complemented the 18 metabolic networks we built before to render a total of 162 different networks. And we applied 10 different network centralities and applied the same statistical procedure that I described to you before to identify the network that contained the highest proportion of predictable indispensable genes in yeast. And this is in panel A. I'm just showing you what I showed you before. Basically, having one single centrality doesn't allow us to make a reliable prediction. Combining more than one centrality in the case of the original metabolic networks was able to achieve statistical significant prediction. But when we use this type of networks combined with the metabolic ones, an interesting behavior happens. In this case, what we observe is that using a single centrality was able to afford reliable predictions, while combining centralities didn't. So changing the network structure was enough to change the concept of what is important for network, for metabolism, which makes sense to me, at least. The best network that we learned here was, again, the KEK metabolic network, and a database of protein-protein interactions in yeast, which is this one, okay? Which comes from protein-protein interactions and high throughput data. And here, the centrality that was relevant for identifying indispensable gene was clustering coefficient. This is a centrality that is local. That means what matters for indispensable genes is what is their neighborhood, direct neighborhood, instead of where in the global network they are located. Okay? But this had, we realized that there were many false predictions in this network. And then we looked more carefully at these networks and we realized that among the predictions we were doing, we were identifying, for example, these type of examples where they, so every circle here represents a protein, okay? The darker the circle, the more central to the network is. The edges connecting these circles represent the type of interaction between these proteins. When it's yellow, that means that this protein is related to this other protein through a metabolite, okay? Which is the first networks that I talked to you about that we built. And so these two genes or proteins are code for the exokinase and these other mutagenase that are known to be indispensable for metabolism and can be predicted in our networks to be indispensable. Then we also have these other type of indispensable proteins that are related through not any metabolite but through protein-protein interactions. In this case, we have the secretory proteins SEC2 and SEC4, but the ones that we were interested in are marking this red circle are those clusters of proteins that include not only protein-protein interactions but metabolite interactions, because in these clusters that's where moonlighting proteins should be. Okay, we will have, for example, the I protein here. It's a protein that catalyzes an enzymatic reaction and also has a protein-protein interaction that could be important for its activity as an enzyme, or could be part of the cytoskeleton or a signal transduction pathway. We don't know. Okay, so I here, the node I, is an example of what we want to predict, a moonlighting protein. So recognizing that what we will expect in this network is this distribution, we came out with the M&M index, which sounds like the chocolates, which is tasty, I hope. And this index is nothing but a number that goes from -1 to 1. -1 meaning there are no moonlighting proteins predicted in this network, and 1 means all your predictions are moonlighting. Okay, so we don't expect to have any network where all the predictions include moonlighting proteins, but we don't want to have a network where the M&M index is equals to -1. Okay. So what you see here is the distribution of this M&M index versus the efficiency in predicting the known indispensable genes for metabolism. And this line is the optimum highest area under the curve value with the largest M&M index values. Okay? And in this line, we identify again that the best Renji network was KEK with a YIPD database. But here the centrality is a different one, still a local centrality that is called sphere degree. I won't go into detail. If you want, I can explain this centrality. This basically is the number of neighbors, of your neighbors. That's the sphere degree. And here comes the predictions of moonlighting proteins in this network is this list. So we predicted 18 moonlighting proteins. The only one that we predicted that was already known in yeast is this one. Okay? There are 3 other proteins in yeast metabolism that are moonlighting proteins, but those we couldn't predict because they are part of metabolic pathways that are not fully annotated in these models of metabolism. So there is lack of information, we cannot make predictions in these areas. The ones that you see marked here in red are those proteins in yeast that have an ortholog for which in Constance database there is evidence that they have a moonlighting activity. So in our predictions, many of the moonlighting proteins in other organisms are predicted to be moonlighting in yeast. That doesn't mean that in yeast they are also moonlighting. The one that I'm marking here with an asterisk is the protein that we are working right now in the lab to validate this prediction. We only have so far preliminary results, so I cannot be certain that this prediction is correct. Our preliminary data suggests that it is, but I still might have the data to be confident that that is the case. So with this, I conclude my presentation. The people that developed this work are presented here. She's Aurora, she's the one that worked in the work that I presented to you in the predicting critical genes based on network, metabolic network using only metabolites. Raul Ortiz, he worked in this last part where we combine protein-protein interaction networks with metabolite networks. Maria Teresa Ortiz, she's a collaborator in my group, and she's been helping Raul to validate his predictions. And Jonathan, he is now a postdoc in my group, and he's taking over what Tere was doing for Raul for testing that hypothesis. So thank you, and if you have any questions, I will be happy to.
I was reading that all of the glycolytic enzymes, all of them are located not only in the cytosol where they function normally, but also are located in the nucleus. Wow! All of the glycolytic enzymes. And five of the enzymes of the Krebs cycle are also located at the nucleus. And they are performing really interesting functions, like they work in transcription or epigenetic modulations. So it's a really, really fascinating topic to me. It is my pleasure now to present to you to Dr. Ana Lilia Torres Machorro, that works at the National Institute of Respiratory Diseases at the Cell Biology Laboratory. Ana Lilia Torres Machorro was awarded the UC Nexus CONACyT postdoctoral fellowship to conduct research in the Division of Biological Sciences at UC San Diego under the supervision of Lorraine Dillus from 2011 to 2013. Torres Machorro uses yeast as a genetic model to study a gene that is affected in many types of cancer, ESA1 TIP60. ESA1 is an enzyme that regulates chromatin, the DNA protein structure that contains the genetic information of the cell. Her work explores conditions that improve the fitness of ESA1 mutant cells, specifically when responding to DNA damage, a pathway that when impaired can lead to cancer. Her results describe the reasons why ESA1 mutant cells are incapable of an efficient repair of damaged DNA. Importantly, she also found different ways to solve ESA1 mutant cell repair problems by improving their ability to ligate broken DNA. These findings may have important implications for clinical research directed toward improved cancer therapies or antifungal drugs. Please come, Ana Lilia, and give us your talk.